resurrection and I am life, says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall have life even though he die. And everyone who has life and has committed himself to me in faith shall not die forever. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. After my awaking, he will raise me up, and in my body I shall see God. I myself shall see, and my eyes behold him who is my friend and not a stranger. For none of us has life in himself, and none becomes his own master when he dies. For if we have life, we are alive in the Lord. And if we die, we die in the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's possession. Happy from now on are those who die in the Lord. So it is, says the Spirit, where they rest from their labors. Rejoice in his eternal glory, who who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns one God forever and ever.
Reading is from Ecclesiastes 3, 1-7, and verse 15. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak. That which is already has been, that which is to be already is, and God seeks out what has gone by.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please join me in saying in unison the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
A reading from 1 Corinthians. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but I do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have prophetic powers and I understand all mysteries and all knowledge, if I have all faith as to have moved mountains, but I do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind, love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist in its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part, but when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror, dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, and the greatest of these, is love. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John. Glory to you, Lord. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated.
I'm so short I can hardly see you all. See me? You can hear me? Can you hear me all right? Hello? This is a time of heartbreaking feelings for all of us who love Joyce so much, but please remember it's a time for celebration, celebration of a life that was well lived, and she was so loved by so many people who knew her. And why was she loved? Because she was so kind. She was so sweet. There was something girl-like about Joyce, even at 70, and you all know it. You know her because she was goodness all in one package, and she was fun, too. She was a party girl. We all were. We sang and danced. Do you remember that as children at home? We knew all the Broadway hits and songs, and I began my spiritual life as a Catholic. I have a German-born mother who was Catholic. And for 8 years, I was a Catholic. And then my mother and father divorced, and my mother married a Mormon. So I went to the stake in Chevy Chase, Maryland, and I danced. My dance partner was always the Meredith's son, J. Willard Marriott, Jr. But in spite of him being a very good dancer, I knew that I had a faith to find of my own. And I asked my stepfather, whom I loved very much, could I find my own faith? And he said, yes, indeed, go. And I did, and I became an Episcopalian. Next October, that will be 74 years. Hooray. I love my church, and I go to St. Philip's Cathedral in Buckhead. And I know all the canons, and I'm making friends there, and I love it. I'm bringing this up because when I met Gordon Dickey, blessedly, he was an Episcopalian too. And we married, and the first 3 years of our marriage, we had 4 children. And I brought along Joyce and Patty from my first marriage. And they were little mothers. Without them, I don't know. You would know, Julia, how difficult it is, 3 children, all little and blessed. We were very happy, but without Joyce and Patty, it just wouldn't have happened. It wouldn't have been easy. It wouldn't have been as much joy as it was. Now, Joyce had one love in her life, it was Michael. They had a really, really fine marriage. You know, when 2 people can talk for 20 minutes without getting angry, without interrupting, with listening and paying attention and saying, this is my partner, this is the way he feels, I'm going to listen to him. And she did. And you were everything to her, Michael. She loved you more than anything, and you were the only man in her life. And we love you, I love you, and we never want to let you go. We all want you to move in with us. You can take turns. You can go from house to house, but there are open arms waiting for you. Laura, did you bring your poem with you? Did you bring your poem? Good. Laura has written a poem, and she's very broken up, as we all are. We're struggling against our tears because we hate to lose Joyce. But last Saturday, Michael called me early in the morning and told me that Joyce had died. And I spent the day alone, even though the twins wanted to come and get me and take me to their hearts and their homes. But I stayed alone because I wanted to. And I cried all day, and I prayed all day. But I'd been praying to Jesus for days, asking Jesus to come and be with Joyce. And I had told Joyce that the time comes when she has to go, that I would personally ask Jesus to come and take her hand and walk her into paradise. So, do you know, at the end of that terrible long day, last Saturday, a wonderful peace came over me. And I felt it was the Holy Spirit comforting me and quieting me, and I knew a stillness inside that I never expected. And I felt Joyce's presence too, just sweetness, calmness, quiet. And I knew then, as I tell you all, that Joyce is with Jesus, and there is no doubt about it. There is heaven, there is paradise, there is a God. Believe with your hearts and still your minds, because her suffering is over. And suffering is not necessary. We just have a right to grieve, and then we heal. Thank you all who've come a distance, who've come by car and by train and by plane, some from Washington State, Pennsylvania. And Shirley, I want to say that you were Joyce's best friend for so many years, and she adored you, and she considered you her sister too. And Janice, you've been like a daughter to me in the beginning. I have, between Joyce and Patty, one and two, Janice said, I'm 2.5. Okay, welcome to the family. And Michelle, I know Michelle since she was born and got to be about that big, and we had a swimming pool in the summer that everybody came to, and Michelle was there in the summer, so we had a joyful, fun time, didn't we all? So this is the first time I've seen Michelle in many years. And there are lots of people I haven't seen yet. I know you're here somewhere, but I won't recognize you, and you won't recognize me. But pull on my elbow and tell me who you are, please. Now, I want to tell you that I cut this out of the bulletin of St. Philip's Cathedral weeks ago. And I learned it in German, because that's my second language, because of my mother. And I'm not going to read it in German. I want you to understand and hear the words. But this is what I'm going to close with. Psalm 51, verses 11 through 13. Create in me, O God, a pure heart, and grant me a new, confident spirit. Cast me not from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Console me again with your support, and may a joyful spirit uphold me. And I wish that for all of you who are grieving and have this terrible loss. But rejoice. We're Christians. We love God. And there are blessings waiting all of us. Amen. Patty? And Laura, will you read?
My earliest childhood memories all include my big sister, Joyce. She was the person that I looked to provide a plan for our day. It was just Mom, Joyce, and me, and we like to call ourselves the Three Musketeers. My first big shock came when I was informed by our grandmother, Lucia, that Joyce was going to be going to this thing that was called kindergarten. And I was not going with her. It was my first realization that I was clueless about what to do with myself. Joyce completely ran the show. When I finally did start school, I couldn't wait until recess when I could find Joyce and just check in. One of my report cards stated that Patty is happiest when she makes contact with Joyce at least once a day. One day, she actually came and found me, and I was elated until she told me that I had to give her my underpants. She had fallen in a puddle and was soaked, And she said it would be okay because I had shorts on and she had a dress on, and that's what I had to do. So reluctantly, I gave her my underwear, knowing good and well that she was not going to take no for an answer anyway. So the next big event in our lives was when Mom met and fell in love with Gordon Dickey, and they married, and he became our father. We fell in love with him too, and shortly thereafter, he adopted us, and he gave us his name. We were a whole family, and it was a wonderful feeling. However, we didn't have a clue about how much better it was going to get when our little sister Lydia was born. I was sort of terrified, but Joyce said that, hey, now we have a real doll to play with, and it's going to be awesome. And it did turn out to be awesome, and we adored our little baby doll. A year and a half later, two more little dolls, Lou and Laura, were born, and Joyce and I were in baby bliss. In no time, we became expert diaper changers, little helpers, and fell head over heels once again in love with these additional little darlings. In another year and a half, our darling brother Douglas was born, and we finally got our little brother and became a family of six. Mom always said she never would have managed without us, but we gladly took on our roles as little nannies and got more and more attached. We often had one or more little bundles crawling into bed with us during the night, which we loved and became a pretty usual happening. Joyce became the supreme boss when we were babysitting, and she took her job very seriously. It was a mantle that she never shed, and she was a great confidant to all of us. We often told her things that we were afraid to tell our parents, and she would usually advise us that it was best to come clean and confess. Her morals were the highest, and she made us walk a tight line. When Joyce was getting ready to go out on her own, I asked her how she was going to be able to leave the littles, as they were called. She said it was going to be the hardest thing she ever did. When Joyce was 17, she and I went on a double date, although I was really just along for the ride. She told me if she didn't like the blind date that she was being set up with, she said, feel free, you know, take your shot. As soon as she saw Michael and was introduced to Michael, she looked at me and she said under her breath, he's mine. I'm like, okay. That was the beginning of a more than 50-year relationship with the love of her life. They fell short a few months before they would have celebrated their 50th wedding anniversary. Michael enlisted in the Army while they were dating and proposed to Joyce before he went to Vietnam for a year. I'm sorry. Joyce was worried sick about her love and was terrified, as we all were, that he wouldn't make it home. He did, though, and in September of 1968, they were married. They had two sons whom we adored, and they were never able to spend a special day or holiday without the entire family being present. Her children meant everything to her, and there was nothing she wouldn't have done for them. She made the best Halloween costumes for them every year, and they usually won first prize in any Halloween procession. Joyce was an incredible artist, and there was really nothing that she couldn't do. She could paint beautiful pictures, sew her own incredible costumes, not only for Brian and James, but for she and Michael. When she decorated for Christmas, it was always stunning and perfect. Her homes were always filled with little critters, adorable little creatures that she made, beautiful curtains that she made herself, countless other crafts that she made to beautify her home or to give as gifts, and I always got one of everything. Many times my friends would see me either wearing or using something Joyce had made and would ask her to make one for them too. So Several people in this room have purchased things from her over the years. Her work was always perfect, and she was by far her worst critic. We lost our daughter, sister, wife, mother, way too soon. And there will be a void in our hearts until we meet her again in heaven. It is a joy to know that she's free of her chains. She's soaring on beautiful wings and smiling her beautiful smile. I love you forever.
Sharing your stories and your experiences. Before I share my words, I want to read that poem that her mother referenced. If you flip to the back of the bulletin, this was written by her sister for her 70th birthday. I, a ship, you, a beacon, a lantern owl, nightlight soft, guiding me from woods and halls dark, shimmering glow, always, ever, through open arms like beams of light calling, whispering to my soul, come hither. I reach for you, my shooting star. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. All of you are gathered here because of your connection to Joyce, or your connection to those grieving the loss of their life partner of over 50 years, grieving the loss of her daughter, or mother, sister, aunt, friend. We are here to celebrate a well-lived life, shared memories, to laugh, to smile, to remember, to cry, to share our grief. But we're also here to proclaim and lean on the truth that God is in the midst of all things, and that in each season of life, the joyful times and the heartbreaking times, that God is with us. The writer of Ecclesiastes reminds us of that so eloquently. For everything there is a season, time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born, time to die, time to weep, time to laugh, time to mourn, time to dance, time to throw away stones, time to gather stones together. That which is already has been. That which is to be already is. And God seeks out what has gone by. No part of life is absent from God. We're also here to proclaim an Easter truth. That God has swallowed up death forever. That God is never done with us. That the very same goodness and mercy that followed Joyce all the days of her life has led her to green pastures and still waters, to the house of the Lord forever. And I believe heaven is not a static place, but a dynamic, creative existence beyond our mind's capacity. A place where she can finish all those projects she creatively envisioned in her mind. I also believe that the way we live this life shows us a glimpse of the life to come. How we loved, our creative spirit, those moments of lightness, of joy, of connectedness. I also believe that heaven is a place of liberation, a place where we're free from whatever limitations our body or mind or spirit has ever placed upon us. The beautiful expressions from Paul's letter to the Corinthians is that notion that our entire life is moving us closer and closer to that love that one day, this day, we'll get to see face to face. And each act of kindness, each expression of love helps us to see in that mirrored a little less dimly. But only now, face to face with God, whose very nature is love, will we see the full and clear beauty and the power of that love. That love that never ends, that endures all things. And we will be held in the arms of that God whose entire property is love. That God who has always loved us. Who made us out of love. Who came into the world, broke into the world to reveal the extent of God's love. God has nudged us and encouraged us and made us to love others. That God, that love, makes us an eternal home forever in the substance of love. Christ has gone before us, prepared a place for us, just for us, and promises to come and take each one of us to himself. Take our hand and lead us to that mansion, that dwelling place prepared just for us. So heed these words. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Yes, grieve. Yes, lean on each other. Shed a tear, shed many tears. But do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust in that Easter truth that the tomb is empty, that your daughter, your wife, your sister, your mother, your friend, your aunt, that God's beloved child, Joyce, is being held in God's outstretched arms and is settling into that place that God made just for her. Amen.
Thank you.
nation with Hear Us, Lord. For our sister Joyce, let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, I am resurrection and I am life. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Joyce, and dry the tears of those who weep.
Hear us, Lord.
You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow.
Hear us, Lord.
You raised the dead to life. Give to our sister eternal life.
Hear us, Lord.
You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our sister to the joys of heaven.
Hear us, Lord.
Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our sister. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. Father of all, we pray to you for Joyce, for all those whom we love but see no longer. Grant to them eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. May her soul and the souls of all the departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Sisters and my brothers, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Be seated. We will continue to have opportunities to lean on each other, to express to Michael our condolences, and share a thought in the parish hall through those doors or around, but through those doors to the parish hall. We've prepared a reception. It's a wonderful opportunity to share memories and thoughts and well wishes and just to lean on each other. So please take the time afterwards to join us in the parish hall. Also, we are going to participate in the celebration of the Eucharist. It is a foretaste of that heavenly banquet that we know Joyce is enjoying this moment. You are all welcome. This is not St. James's table or the Episcopal Church's table. This is God's table, and God welcomes you. You're invited to come forward to receive. Just have your hands extended, and you can receive the bread and or the wine. And if you prefer a blessing, just come forward with your arms crossed. We'll come forward. We'll go all the way to that end and work our way across. The ushers will guide us forward. Also, if there is anybody who would like to receive communion, who's unable to make their way to the altar, please let one of the ushers know, and we will bring communion to you. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice. Thank you. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who rose victorious from the dead and comforts us with the blessed hope of everlasting life. For to your faithful people, O Lord, life is changed, not ended. When our mortal body lies in death, there is prepared for us a dwelling place eternal in the heavens. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. When we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he gave thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." Alleluia, Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thank you. stand as we pray. Almighty God, we thank you that in your great love you have fed us with the spiritual food and drink of the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, and have given us a foretaste of your heavenly banquet. Grant that this sacrament may be to us a comfort in affliction and a pledge of our inheritance in that kingdom where there is no death, neither sorrow nor crying, but the fullness of joy with all your saints. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sign but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind. We are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return, for so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Joyce. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech thee, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light.
Amen.
Remember that life is short. We have too little time to gladden the hearts of those who travel the way with us. So be quick to be kind. Make haste to love. And the blessing of God Almighty, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia.